Good morning, dear children. All of you are doing well. Very happy to hear the instructions and all. Everyone, please actually do your work properly and be up to date with the submission of notes, assignments, and all. I hope you got the portions for the exam also. Actually, we have only one lesson only, control and coordination only. That is what we recently studied. This month we completed this control and coordination. We are coming to the end only. Few more points only have to be discussed. In the next class I will be doing the revision. So you have to go through the whole lesson, just revise and come for the next class also. And the first lesson that will be included for the TAM exam. Okay, now you have to concentrate on our control and coordination only. This is to make your work easy so that you can score very good marks. And regarding your examination, please keep some points in your mind. You have to actually listen to or revise the classes already downloaded. That is actually, I hope you have downloaded in your system or in your phone, you might have downloaded all our classes. These videos also you have to listen, because questions will be asked from that. Actually, what is discussed in the class, what is given in the note, what is there in the textbook. So you have to refer all this. This is actually a preparation for this, a kind of preparation for the board exam also. Board exam also you have to cover the whole lesson, actually whole each and every point given in the textbook and whatever given in the notebook and whatever discussed in the class, everything you have to this revise and this memorize, and that's very very important. So that's a actually you will get a practice for our final exam also. Now we'll be beginning with this. Few points only, all these things we have studied, few more questions only we are discussing. First we will be discussing about the differences between the involuntary action and reflex action. And reflex action we have studied, children, that is a very quick response, and this is actually quick and a rapid response. Actually it is a rapid response, quick response, and this is automatic. And involuntary, this is actually involuntary, means it is not under the control of our will. This kind of this reflex actions are unconscious actions, it is not under the control of our will only. They are very quick and rapid automatic reactions of the affects, that means muscles and glands. Suppose you are touching a very hot object, all of a sudden you withdraw your hand, somebody throw any object into your this eyes, you will actually close your eyes, you will blink your eyes when it is when you look at this hot sun, so hot sun, or when bright light falls on your eyes, you blink your eyes. All these are examples of the reflex actions. So reflex actions, you must say, it is actually quick reactions of the body, rapid reactions of this unconscious, and this reactions that is done with the help of affects. Affects are muscles as well as the glands, and these are completely controlled by our spinal cord, and it is not under the control of our will. That's why we will call it as involuntary actions only. And here, children, it is not consciously controlled by our brain, and it is controlled by the spinal cord only. Actually this reflex actions are meant for meeting with this or facing emergency situations only. Okay, emergency situations, for example, you are touching a hot object unknowingly, or you are withdrawing your hand all of a sudden in order to prevent your body from getting burnt. Okay, so here, children, that's an emergency condition. During emergency condition only reflex actions are applied. But in the case of the involuntary actions, this is actually here a set of muscle movement that is controlled by our brain only. I will tell you the example, then you can understand. For the peristalsis, you know, children, contraction, alternate contraction, relaxation of the walls of the elementary canal which pushes the foot forward, and this is peristalsis. Also our heartbeat is there, and then here, children, beating of the heart, that is another example. Okay, and respiration. Respiration, you know, the breaking up of this glucose to release energy. And here in all these cases, these are involuntary actions. These are controlled by this remember, which part of our brain controls the involuntary actions. All the involuntary actions like heartbeat is there, peristalsis is there, everything controlled by the medulla of the brain. So you must understand, children, these involuntary actions are the actions controlled by the brain only. Here you know these involuntary actions, these particular actions are controlled by the medulla. And here, children, there is no role for the spinal cord. And here, so reflex actions are controlled by the spinal cord, but these involuntary actions are controlled by the medulla of the brain. And involuntary actions, actually, they are a set of muscle movements and over which we don't have any control. We can't stop our heartbeat. We can't control our peristalsis. Okay, so these involuntary actions are not at all under our control, and also they are relatively small, these are slower processes. But in the case of reflex actions, they are very quick and actually rapid actions, quick actions. They are automatic reactions of the effectors. Okay, that is both muscles and the glands. So these are the differences between these involuntary actions and also the reflex actions. So you have to see, children. Now we'll see a comparison between the nervous and hormonal systems. We have seen the importance of hormonal system as well as nervous system. Nervous system actually help in controlling and coordination, and with the help of the brain, spinal cord, brain and spinal cord together make central nervous system. Cranial nerves and spinal nerves together make our this peripheral nervous system. They together control, and brain, spinal cord, all these nerves together help in controlling and coordinating all the actions in the body. But we have seen, children, in the case of multicellular organisms, there is another need of the hormonal system or chemical coordination. What's the need of chemical coordination? Chemical coordination in our body, that is very much essential, because for the production of the nerve impulses. Suppose a particular cell generates, say, this nerve impulse, and this nerve impulse is actually this generated by a sensory neuron, and then it actually this detects some impulses from any of the sense organs. A nerve impulse is generated and it is transmitted. For the generation of the next nerve impulse, it takes some more time. Okay, so the cell has to reset its mechanisms to generate and transmit the next electrical impulse or the nerve impulse. So that is one reason we need a chemical coordination or this hormonal coordination. And also, children, this is a chemical. Here in the case of nervous coordination, these messages will reach only those parts of our body which are connected with the nerves. That's here lies the need of a hormonal system or this chemical coordination. So chemical coordination, as you know, it is done with the help of four, children, these hormones only. Hormones are produced by the endocrine glands. So we can say endocrine glands are the units of the endocrine system, and they are poured directly into the bloodstream, and they don't have any ducts at all, endocrine glands. That's why we'll call them as ductless glands. And these are carried, hormones are carried by the bloodstream to the target organs or target sites. And hormones are very specific in action. They act on the target sites only. And hormones, actually, they are chemicals secreted by the endocrine glands. So we'll make a comparison. All these things we know. This we know about the nervous system, we know about the endocrine system. And here in the case of nervous system, here, children, it is made up of the basic units are neurons or nerve cells. Very simple, we know. But in the case of the endocrine system, the basic units, structural and functional units, are here endocrine glands. That is, in the case of the hormonal system or chemical system or endocrine system, the basic units are the endocrine glands. But in the case of the nervous system, these the basic units are the neurons or these nerve cells. Based on this, I have sent the notes today. You will be getting notes, and you need not copy this PPT at this table and all. You need not copy from this screen. And so you have to listen to me now. I have given and I have modified all this and given you the notes. and so that not only you have to copy. One more thing I have to tell you children, I gave you a table on endocrine glands and hormones. Everyone should copy it into your notebook as well as in your assignment book. That is an assignment I am giving you. Okay, very important. Sure questions will be asked for your board exam. And here children, in the case of the nervous system, the messages or information is transmitted in the form of electrical impulses. But here children, in the case of the endocrine system, the messages are transmitted in the form of chemicals called hormones. Okay, so you must understand, in the case of the nervous system, the information, instructions, they are carried in the form of electrical impulses or nerve impulses, and also there the chemicals are also produced at the synapse children, that is neurotransmitters. So you must understand children, the information is transmitted in the form of electrical impulses through neurotransmitters, which are the chemicals produced at the where children, nerve endings only these neurotransmitters are produced. That is actually this nerve impulse is converted into chemical signals, and these neurotransmitters, they pass across the synapse. So here children, the impulses are carried in the nervous system in the form of electrical impulses through neurotransmitters. Here the messages are in the endocrine system, it is carried in the form of chemicals. Here the chemicals are hormones. In the case of nervous system, the chemicals are the neurotransmitters. Neurotransmitter acetylcholine is there, we studied, or at least one example you have to study. Here children, nervous system, the speed of information or the transmission of impulses, it is very quick. We have seen so many examples. When I ask you a question, at that moment itself you are giving the answer. Then so many things are actually, so many processes take place in the nervous system. Our sensory, this our, your ears, your eyes, actually this receive the information, receive the stimuli, that is my sound, and so you may be seeing my lip movement also. So messages from your eyes and ears carried through the sensory nerves to the brain, cerebrum interpret the question and gives you the answer, and the message, this instruction is carried through the motor neurons to the muscle of the tongue. All of a sudden you are saying the answer, fraction of a second it will take. So we can say the impulse is transmitted very quickly in the case of the nervous system. But here children, hormones, here the messages are carried by the hormones comparatively at a slower rate. This actually messages are carried slowly only, but in the case of certain, and that is the general, this situation in the case of the hormones, the messages are carried by the hormones comparatively slowly when we take the case of the nervous system. Until and all as fast, but when compared to the nervous system, it is still slower. Then here children, speed of transmission of the impulse, here it is fast in nervous system, in the endocrine system it is slow. And here children, in the case of the nervous system, the duration of that response or the effect of the nerve impulse, how long it lasts, it lasts for a short duration only. That effect of that or children nerve impulse is for a short duration. The nerve impulse, its effect, that in the nervous system some action is done and it effect lasts for a shorter duration only. But in the case of the endocrine system, the duration of the effect of hormones, that lasts for a longer period. Growth hormone, its effect is longer. And in the case of this here children, the insulin secreted by the pancreas, and here it reduces the high sugar level to normal. So here its effect lasts for a longer period. Response by muscle contraction or here secretion by glands, that means here in the case of the nervous system, response is done with the help of the effectase only. Effectase, you are running, you see a dog and start running, then what happens, and the response is done with the help of the muscles of the leg as well as your gland, adrenaline is secreted by adrenal gland. So you must understand, response is done with the help of effectase. Effectase are the muscles and the glands. Now here children, in the case of the hormonal system, you know how responses are taking place. For example, the action of the here children insulin, typical example. Here what happens, insulin, how does it act? Whenever the blood glucose level is excess, it is converted into, glucose is converted into glycogen by the action of the insulin. And here what happens is, you remember we studied, here responses are glucose to glycogen, that is done with the help of the hormone insulin. Glucose, excess glucose is converted into glycogen by the action of the insulin secreted by the beta cells of the pancreas. This is how children, the response takes place. So the glucose level is maintained to normal, and protein synthesis is there, that is done with the help of protein metabolism, done with the help of our thyroxine hormone. Rate of respiration controlled by the adrenaline hormone. So you must understand, children, here the responses are done in a different way, either by the conversion of the glucose to glycogen, that is done by insulin, and rate of respiration increases, done with the help of adrenaline hormone secreted by adrenal glands, and also here protein synthesis, protein metabolism, done with the help of our thyroxine hormone secreted by thyroid gland. So this is how responses are made. So you must see the differences between the nervous system and the hormonal system, or the chemical coordination as well as this nervous coordination. That's the difference. Okay, children. Now we'll see the next one. We'll see, children, endocrine system we have already studied, and then hormone secreted, and hormone secreted, this is the last actually table I gave you, and about this table, and each and every this hormone is very very important. And when you study about these hormones, hypothalamus, you remember, children, one or two points I will tell you. Hypothalamus, you study, hypothalamus controls our thirst, hunger, body temperature. Hypothalamus also produce releasing factors as well as the inhibitor. Releasing hormones are there, inhibitory hormones. Releasing hormones actually stimulate the production of certain hormones by the pituitary gland, and the inhibitory hormones produced by hypothalamus inhibits the pituitary gland from secreting certain hormones. So here, children, so here a feedback mechanism works, and when you study about hypothalamus, you have to keep in mind this, just remember only, just keep in mind, you write this point somewhere and keep in mind. Hypothalamus also produces two more hormones, that is the first hormone we can say oxytocin, and the second hormone is known as the vasopressin. Vasopressin and oxytocin, these are the two hormones secreted by the hypothalamus, but these two hormones are, they are stored in the posterior part of the pituitary gland. Pituitary gland has an anterior part and posterior part, and anterior part actually produces so many these hormones. We have seen thyroid stimulating hormone and all, and the posterior part, here in this posterior part of the pituitary gland only, this oxytocin and vasopressin are, they are stored, and they are secreted from the posterior part of the pituitary gland only, but actually they are produced by the hypothalamus. We will see vasopressin, it has another name also, that is, otherwise vasopressin is known as antidiuretic hormone, or ADH, antidiuretic hormone, or ADH. That is the another name for the, what, children, the vasopressin, ADH. And I hope some of you might have heard this term earlier. Vasopressin, we will study about the function of vasopressin first. Its function is to control the reabsorption of the water in the renal tubules or nephrons. You have studied nephrons, these are the basic structural and functional units of what, children? Nephrons are the basic and structural and functional units of our excretory system, kidneys. Okay, and these nephrons, they have a number of functions. Nephrons help in this filtering our blood, production of the urine, and during the production of urine, when filtration of the blood is done, so many substances, important salts, and like calcium, this calcium is there, potassium is there, important salts are there, amino acids is there, and also glucose and water is also reabsorbed in the kidney tubules or renal tubules. So this reabsorption of water in the renal tubules or the nephron, that is controlled with the help of this ADH hormone. ADH hormone help in the reabsorption of water from the kidney tubules, reabsorption of water. Okay, so here I will tell you what is happening, children. In the renal tubule, you know, in the rainy season, so when more water is there, is a correlation between the amount of urine produced and the amount of water this reabsorbed. And actually here, children, you have to understand, whenever more water is reabsorbed in the renal tubules or nephrons, less urine is produced. Okay, that happens during the summer season because our body already loses a lot of water through sweating. So the body has to save water. Understood? So in that case, what is happening is, children, more ADH will be produced, and this is produced by hypothalamus stored in the posterior part of the pituitary gland, and this vasopressin or ADH is produced in more amount in the summer season, and more water is reabsorbed in the summer season, so that less urine is produced. That is one, this, that is the actually one of the factors which controls the amount of urine produced and the amount of water reabsorbed in the renal tubules. Then in the rainy season, you know, children, there is less chance of perspiration or the sweating. Our body loses less water through what, children? Through the sweating. So there is no need of reabsorbing too much water in the renal tubule. So less water will be reabsorbed in the renal tubule. So less ADH will be secreted by this, what, children? The posterior part of the pituitary. And less this ADH will be produced also. So more this less ADH will be produced, and less water will be reabsorbed. So more urine is produced in the rainy season, winter season, etc., because there is less chance of this perspiration or this sweating during the winter as well as the rainy season. That you have to understand. So that's all about antidiuretic hormone. And one more thing I have to remind you, children, this year also they have asked me question, what are the factors, 10th standard board exam, what are the factors on which the amount of water reabsorbed in the renal tubules depend on? Then you have to write the two points first. The first point is how much excess water is there in the body. Suppose there is too much excess water, that is here in the case of here, children, winter season, rainy season, more water is actually there in the body. So what happens, children? More urine is produced. Okay, and how much excess water is there in the body, and how much nitrogenous waste have to be excreted, nitrogenous waste like urea, uric acid, ammonia, etc. So how much nitrogenous waste has have to be excreted, and the more waste, suppose there is more waste present or formed in the kidneys, this should be expelled so that more urine is produced. So these are the two factors. So when that question is asked, these two points you have to write first, then you can this mention this also. So the first two points, because whenever you write board exam, children, whatever points given in the textbook, that should be written. That's very, very important. Okay, So that 2 points you have to write. How much excess water is there in the body? How much nitrogenous waste has to be expelled? These are the two factors on which the amount of urine produced or the amount of water reabsorbed in the renal tubules depend on. Okay. After writing this, you can mention about this also. Then we'll see the case of oxytocin. Oxytocin is a hormone that stimulates childbirth. Child labor. Labor, you know what is labor, children? Child labor or childbirth. And here what happens is labor or this childbirth, I will tell you, and childbirth under, then this otherwise it will be confusing. Childbirth or labor. Labor. And this that is controlled during this labor, and there should be the contraction of the uterine muscles. Uterine muscles contract and relax. Actually, that contraction is very much important for expelling the baby during this labor or childbirth. And this is done with the help of the oxytocin produced by the hypothalamus and stored in the posterior part of the pituitary gland. So you must understand, children, it induces labor. The labor, that is this, you know, children giving birth to a baby, that is called parturition. Parturition, and here giving birth to a, that process, and here you will be studying in the next lesson. Then the childbirth, during the childbirth, during the labor, there should be contraction of the strong contraction of the uterine muscles that only expel the baby, and this childbirth is induced by the oxytocin produced by our hypothalamus. That you have to understand, children. Okay, now we see, children, this we will revise after some time, and before that I want to tell you one more point, children, that is, how does nervous tissue help in the cause this movements? How does nervous tissue cause movements? That we will see now. Whenever, how does nervous tissue cause movement, or how do muscles move? That actually this answer already it is given in the note. And how do muscle cells move? How do muscle cells move? We'll see how do they move. Muscles, how do they move? In the case of the muscle, children, in the last year you might have studied about striated muscle, non-striated muscle. Skeletal muscles are there, and the skeletal muscles are the muscles which are attached with our forelimbs and hind limbs, and actually they contract, and they contract, these muscles contract, and they always pull the bones, and that actually bring about movements. And we will see how do these muscles actually this bring about various kinds of movement. In the case of the muscles, there are special type of proteins. These special type of proteins in the muscles, we will call them as contractile proteins. In the muscles, there are special type of proteins called contractile proteins. And these contractile proteins, you know, different types are there. This actin, myosin and all, different type of they are contractile proteins. The collective name you have to keep in mind. And here, children, these contractile proteins, they change both their shape, they change the shape and arrangement in the muscles. So the contractile proteins, what do, children? They change their shape and arrangement of these proteins. So both these contractile proteins, when they are present in the muscles, they change both their shape and arrangement. When they change their shape and arrangement, what happens, children? They shorten. When they shorten, what happens? Contraction occurs, and as a result, when they shorten means they contract. This contraction of muscles pull the bones connected with them. These are skeletal muscles mainly. Skeletal muscles actually they pull the bones. You know, children, one set of muscles, actually two muscles are required for bringing about any kind of these movements. For example, biceps actually situated here and triceps. Whenever we want to raise our hand, biceps contract and help in raising our hand. And when we are pulling our hand down, what happens? Triceps present at the back side, they contract and help in actually this stretching our hand down. So you have to understand the how do muscles tissue cause movement. That's important. in the muscles there are special type of proteins. These special type of proteins called contractile proteins. Whenever any nerve impulse reaches a particular muscle, you know children what happens in the motor neurons carry the instructions or commands from the brain as well as from the spinal cord to the muscles of our hand. Then only these actions are this brought about. That only bring about various kinds of actions. That is done with the help of the effectase. You know what happens? These effectase are the muscles. Effectase, there are muscles as well as glands. So how do these effectase, that is muscles, they cause this movement? So whenever any nerve impulse that is carried by a motor neuron reaches a particular muscle, the contractile proteins present in the muscles, they change their shape as well as this arrangement in the muscle, and as a result they shorten. And when they shorten, you know what happens? When they shorten, they contract, and this contraction brings about various type of movements. Contraction pull the bones and brings about various kinds of movements. So you must understand children, here the muscles also help in this keeping our balance of the body, making various kinds of movements. The muscles are helpful. Okay, so here children, coordination in our body, that is done with the help of the muscular tissue also, because the here children keeping the balance of our body, that is done with the help of the muscle. Muscular movements are very much important, understood? Coordinating these activities, these muscular tissues also help, because the suppose you are performing any this aerobics you are performing, or you are dancing, and all this muscular coordination, that's very much important, isn't it children? So this this muscular coordination, even though they are voluntary activities, they are controlled by the, they are actually this precision, it is controlled by the cerebellum also. So here children, muscles also play an important role. Muscles controlled by the brain, that plays an important role in coordination in our this body. So here children, muscles contain contractile proteins. Whenever any nerve impulse carried by the motor neuron reaches the muscle, the contractile proteins change their shape and arrangement in the muscle. As a result, they shorten, and so when they shorten, what happens children? The shape of the muscles also, this become short, and muscles also contract. When the muscular these proteins, they contract. This is how they bring about movements. And some more points I have to tell you children. Here what happens is, when you hear the term gonads, you know children, gonads, what are gonads actually? Gonads means, suppose a question is asked, what are the hormones produced by your gonads? Okay, or name the gonads in the human reproductive, humans this a body. Gonads are this both the testes and ovaries. And so another name for gonads are testes and ovaries. And these gonads actually this, they produce various hormones, and we have testosterone produced by the testes, ovaries produce estrogen and progesterone. All this actually you have to study from the table also. Please this make, you have to be thorough with the table also about this endocrine glands. And next children, one more point I have to tell you. When you think about the spinal cord, suppose there is an injury in the spinal cord. Spinal cord injury, you know how does it affect spinal cord injury? Spinal cord actually controls our reflex action. And during an accident, if somebody gets an injury, serious injury, or this actually even minor injuries are very dangerous in the case of spinal cord, medulla, etc., because they are very vital organs. You know, spinal cord, it controls our reflex actions. So what happens is children, the reflex actions will be interrupted. Whenever there is a spinal cord injury, our reflex actions will be interrupted, as well as children, all the messages to the brain, as well as all the instructions from the brain to the muscles and glands, that is carried through the spinal cord. So all the instructions to and from the muscles and glands from the brain, all the messages to the brain from the sensory organs, these are carried actually through the spinal cord. So all the messages carried to and from the brain through the spinal cord, that also will be interrupted in the case of a spinal cord injury. So reflex actions will be interrupted, as well as the all the messages to the brain and from the brain, that will be interrupted in the case of a spinal cord injury. Now we'll see, children, another important point you have to remember. How do you detect the smell of agarbatti? You know, agarbatti has a very sweet smell, a fragrance. So whenever agarbatti burns, the vapors are actually this spread into the air, that actually these vapors, they diffuse into the air and that contains a characteristic smell. You know what happens, these smell actually, these molecules, they detect the olfactory receptors are there. These olfactory receptors present in your nasal cavity, they will be stimulated. Okay, so these olfactory, we have studied about all the receptors are very important. Olfactory receptors in the nasal cavity, they will be stimulated by this smell, particular smell. And these olfactory receptors are connected with the sensory nerve. So as a result of this smell, that stimulus of smell, there is a chemical this are produced in the sensory nerve, that is olfactory nerve connected with the olfactory receptors. And this actually chemical produces an electrical impulse or nerve impulse. This nerve impulse is carried by the sensory nerve to the cerebrum. In the cerebrum, you know, children, there are olfactory areas. These olfactory areas in the cerebrum help you to, these olfactory areas are there, these olfactory areas in the cerebrum helps you to detect the smell as well as identify what kind of smell it is. So these olfactory areas in the cerebrum help you to detect the smell and identify the smell. So you must understand, whenever this smell of this agarbatti, that actually this passes through your nasal cavity, these olfactory receptors are stimulated, and as a result olfactory neurons, these neurons are there, sensory neurons are there, they got stimulated, and a chemical this is produced. Actually this chemical is produced in the sensory neuron, and as a result of production of this chemical, a nerve impulse is produced. Nerve impulse is carried by the sensory neuron to the cerebrum. The olfactory areas in the cerebrum help you to detect the particular smell as well as to identify whether it is a sweet smell or this foul smell. And also that's all about our nervous system. It is completed. Next day you have to come prepared for the revision. I'll be asking you questions, so come prepared, okay children, and go through the videos also once again, and then study the notes textbook. Thanks a lot for listening. Have a nice day. Interaction illa illa.